Well, welcome, everybody. Glad to have you along on this Wednesday. That's John King over there. John is not a happy man today. He's just been watching some YouTube videos of two people who were victorious in primaries yesterday that he's not terribly fond of.
So. Yeah, I think there's now a better understanding for me why all the monster movies feature New York. Because it is the city of political monsters. You've generated three of them so far this cycle, and even though Hillary, she announced yesterday that New York is her actual hometown, even though she's from out of state. I have to ask you, Bob.
Wait a minute, you got a beef with me today here?
I got a beef with you.
Because I understand, pal, you and I are going to have to step outside here in a couple of minutes, and I'm going to have to whoop you.
New York showed overwhelming favorability to the two candidates that the rest of the country, and actually even probably including New York in polls, show are the least favorable candidates. Why do you think that is?
Well, first of all, I'm not surprised. It is New York. And let's be clear, New York City is not New York State. It has a great impact economically, politically, socially, but everybody thinks of New York. Let me step back. Not everybody. Many people, when you say New York, what do you think about?
Elites, rich people.
About New York City, you think about Long Island, and about 12 million people living in a fairly congested area. There's a lot of cows. There's a lot of forest, a lot of lakes in upstate New York. So look at the map and consider where it is, and then look at this vast, very large state.
Yeah, but the majority of the people
live in New York, metropolitan area. Yeah. And they, of course, are going to have, understandably, a major disproportionate effect on everything that happens in New York State. So, you know, I'm not surprised. I mean, Hillary was polling well. Sanders, you know, I never expected him to win New York. I didn't think, based on the polling, Cruz got his butt kicked. Kasich wins the county of New York, which is, John?
Manhattan.
Okay, he gets the votes there. But Trump needed more than 50%, right? He gets 60-something percent, so an overwhelming New York State mandate for Trump.
Let me follow this up with another question. So Trump overwhelming, more than 60%, as we said, wins New York. All of the votes that Trump got together, all of the individuals that voted for Trump, equal less than half of the people that voted for Hillary in the same state. She got 2-1, basically. Right. And she didn't even get 50%, or just a little, like 51% of the Democratic ticket. So follow-up question for you. Why are so many New Yorkers Democrats?
There's a long, long history when you look at the origins of New York City and then hence New York State. But let's just talk about New York City and Long Island. This is the epicenter of immigrants legally coming to the United States, correct?
Right.
So they come to the United States. What do they face, guys?
Discrimination.
Well, they face massive forms of discrimination.
Right.
There are no labor laws. If you go back and read anything about just the industrialization of this area.
Just watch the movie Gangs of New York.
Gangs of New York is a pretty good representation of kind of the power play. So you had the owners, the elite, the property owners, those that could vote, those that had the wealth, a very small minority controlling vast amounts of the economic, region. So what are you bringing into the country? Massive amounts of labor. These are people that are not coming, you know, with a lot of wealth. They're poor. They're coming from different parts of Europe, Northern Europe, Southern Europe. So when they arrive, just think about the conditions that they faced. If you go down to Lower Manhattan.
So if you don't want to be discriminated, why would you join the party of discrimination?
Well, look, this is an evolution, too. You know, we're talking about the Democratic Party today, about where the origins of why you're asking your question in terms of originally. Go to the Bowery.
Yeah, I mean, but because when you're talking about, there was like either Jim Crow laws in the Democratic world or there was slavery. I mean, like this is the party of discrimination.
We're talking about pre-Civil War.
I don't know where you're at in the history.
I'm going back to history literally from like 1700s into the modern industrial time.
Okay.
We start thinking about what the country was like and what people did not have in terms of access to voting, to power, to any of the things that, you know, we kind of take for granted today. So it really would be a wonderful exercise for people to go back, read the history and origin of New York City and why it is and remain such a strong Democrat. Because we can talk today and say, John, you're right. But
let me ask you, even today, despite all these Democrats running everything for us, like federal level Democratic spots, you like Republican governors. Like, you just love them all the time. Republican governor, it seems.
Cuomo?
And Republican mayors.
Well, Cuomo, in the last eight years, it's shifted a little bit. But before that, I mean, there was a long history of either, you know, kind of centrist Republicans or slightly left Republicans. I mean, whether it's Giuliani, for example. I mean, that was a long tenure there. Bloomberg kind of ran as a Republican.
And you look at when Giuliani came into power, what was New York City going through? It was the dumps. All right, New York was, the crime rates were out of control. The garbage wasn't picked up.
And who ran the place? It was Democrats.
Exactly. So New York City said, we're fed up. So there's always points in time.
And we'll elect, if you will, a token Republican to come in to clean things up, and now we're done with that.
You know, Giuliani comes in. Remember, he was the district attorney.
Right, yeah.
And he had his own baggage that followed him into, becoming mayor of New York City. But at any point in time, sometimes the populace will say, look, traditionally we're Democrats, but this isn't working. Maybe it's time we try somebody new.
Yeah.
And Giuliani was the perfect foil for that.
Let's get Catherine on the line, because I know, as extremely intelligent as she is, she has a cogent comment to share. Hi,
Catherine. Good morning, Catherine.
Good morning, Peter. You're buttering me up.
Be cogent for us, please.
Okay. Well, I was just going to say that, if you look at it also from a sociological perspective, the more people aggregate together, the more rules are instituted to smooth the interactions between groups and also between individuals.
Or else they just kill each other.
Exactly. And so the more services are needed. When you live in a small town, you can, take your garbage to the dump by yourself. When you live in a huge city, there needs to be services in order to take care of the detritus of living, so to speak. And also, the other thing is that the more people that are put together in a small place, the less responsibility individuals are willing to take for their own taking care of their own business. Do you understand? So they're much more willing to put the responsibility onto other people.
It's easier to make efficiencies when people can specialize, because you have more people to specialize.
Exactly. So just wanted to throw that into the mix.
But what's your connection with that to New York and the way it votes?
The way it votes?
Yeah.
Well, because Democrats are much more collective and much more group-oriented than supposedly Republicans, although, I think Republicans are just as much group-oriented. They just want to hold the power. But Democrats are much better at saying that they're willing to take from one group in order to spread the wealth around. You know, that's been the way things have gone for a long, long time, and that appeals to human nature, the dark side of human nature, I think, where people have no problem giving up responsibility if somebody will give them something in return for it.
All right.
Makes sense.
We're up against a break. Thanks, Catherine.
All right, sure. Bye.
Appreciate the call. We'll continue. Bob is looking very thoughtful about that, as is John. Marcus is waiting to visit. We have two lines open. We have got open phones for the first half hour. Got a special guest coming on with us, I believe, at 9. So stay with us. We'll be right back. You guys have been missing an amazing little history lesson here from Bob. I mean, I just kind of wish we could put that out over the top of the commercials, but they wouldn't like that. So.
And trust me, when Peter's impressed with history, that's saying something.
I like history. I am history.
You lived half
I'm
of
old,
it.
For crying out loud.
From another New Yorker, this is from Elena. She says, from another New Yorker, the Democrats of yesteryear are not the Democrats of today. Why is New York City so liberal Democrat? Why is Missoula? Personally, I think the last great president we had was JFK.
And John, that's one of the questions you asked. I was trying to give you some insight into. She's absolutely right. And throughout any era, you can't just say this is the Democratic Party of 1900 being the Democratic Party of 2015.
So are you saying that the Democratic Party is simply a hand-me-down from years past when it was in its glory?
I can't say that. Okay. But what I can see in terms of what's happened is the Democratic Party has become a party of the educated elite in terms of who gets elected, who who has the power. Look at the media. Look at the West Coast, East Coast. You always hear about that. Look at the Googles of the world. Look at the, you know, Microsofts. I mean, these are people that are, have historically at least been Democratic, but they're now doing it with a different economic bent.
And their view is, and this is what I get, okay, just from the outside looking in, their view seems to be, we know better than you uncultured trash from flyover country. So let us handle the important things like who's going to be president, who's going to run our country, and you guys just go ahead and work and pay the taxes. So am I wrong?
No, I think I feel personally there's a degree of truth in that, in okay. terms of losing that connection. When you say working class Democrats,
right. yeah.
my dad was an electrician. Growing up on Long Island, he was a union guy. You want to talk about a bunch of union, blue-collar Democrats, they're not, and we're not, the educated elite of Manhattan.
Yeah, those union Democrats, many of them are in the Trump camp now.
And the question you should ask is why.
All right, well, let's get to the phone. Marcus, you're on TalkBack. Hi.
Well, I can tell you why.
Okay, go for it.
Well, I think that there's a little bit Trump is actually running as a blue dog Democrat, disguised as a Republican.
I agree with you, Marcus.
And I think that a lot of the, you know, he's pulling the, what they call the Reagan Democrats, you know, these blue-collar workers and whatnot. I mean, New York has lost, you know, 3 out of 4 manufacturing jobs in, you know, the last half century or whatever. The jobs have literally disappeared, and I think that in retrospect, you come back to, are you a globalist and a neocon, or are you a nationalist? And if you look at the election right now, you have Hillary Clinton and Cruz are both globalists and neocons, and Trump and Sanders are nationalists.
What makes Cruz a globalist?
I believe, and I may be incorrect, you know, this is subject to more research, but I believe that he has supported several bills.
He's against TPP, which I think would be the biggest, what people might frame as a globalist piece of paper.
I was under the impression that he was supportive of that.
No, he's against it. It's one of the reasons I don't like Cruz, but yeah, he's against TPP.
I believe John is right, Marcus, and this is always okay. Where I love this show, because if we have a disagreement, let's Google.
Yeah, you know, I love it.
Let's find out if we're wrong about this, because I think John may be right here in terms of
Ted Cruz's
policy.
Quote, to politic quack. That should be, someone needs to trademark politic quack.
Thank you, Mr. Freud. Yeah.
He says, I have always opposed the TPP.
Yeah.
Okay. And then maybe he's not as much. I thought he was more pro, he had been in favor of some bills that was going to greatly increase the number of foreign workers and
that doesn't
that sort
sound
of thing.
Like Cruz.
Let's go back to the other accusation. Aside from globalist, though, neocon. What do you think that means?
To me, a neocon is someone that is basically in favor of the New World Order. This would be the Bushes and the Clintons. This is where you allow supposedly free trade, although we know it's not really free. There's still all these tariffs and stuff. They just manipulate the tariffs to favor certain groups.
Wouldn't that be the same as globalist? I always associated the people that use the term neocon with people talking about war efforts by the United States, specifically Iraq. That was a neocon venture, for example.
Well, that's tied in because, I mean, and I don't want to get too conspiracy theory, but some people believe that the trade groups are run by the mob, and so basically, and they buy the politicians, so then the politicians vote for free trade, and that is where the drug running and the weapons running and getting involved in foreign wars ad infinitum all comes from, is that you're basically, you've got the gun runners, the drug runners, and the free trade people are all the same people, and they're benefiting from this situation we have.
So you think that it makes, when you make goods easier to trade legally, it also increases illegal trade in your mind?
I don't think that they're necessarily making it easier for trades goods to trade. I've been involved in some international trade, mm-hmm. And there's still plenty of tariffs. You know, there's if you've ever looked at the tariff log, it's this ginormous thing.
Sure, sure. I'm not saying that we don't have tariffs and things like that, but I think it's really hard to say that we don't have more trade now and easier trade between Canada and Mexico than we did before NAFTA.
I think it's easier for us to buy foreign goods.
Sure, that's part of it.
I do not think it is necessarily easier for foreigners to buy American goods. Importing something to China is not necessarily as easy it is.
I may not be right on this, but I think I am. I'll look it up. I think still today the United States is the largest exporter in the world.
John is correct. And that's a total cumulative of all goods and services.
Marcus, hey, do this to you. We're up against a break. Appreciate your call. Hey, call again, okay?
All right.
Very thoughtful comments. We appreciate it. 721-1290. We'll come right back at just after 9 o'clock, visiting with a gentleman from the Brookings Institution, and we'll be talking about what's going on in the Middle East. So stay with us. We still have a few minutes left of Open Phone. All right, we're back on Talkback. 721-1290 is on. I've got about 3.5 minutes before we get to the top of the hour. By the way, great story yesterday, John. We had Mr. Beebe on the air on Talkback, and then you had him do a whiteboard demonstration that you made into a video and put it on our website, and it's just blowing up. It's amazing.
And you can see the math that he used. Now, this is an interesting perspective because he is the guy that did the math on the rates that we've had in Missoula since 2012,
right?
For Mountain Water Company. And he compares, the basic inputs and, the basic cost to what the city would have to pay or what we in the city would have to pay, assuming some basic things that we know. For example, an $88 million purchase price, if that's the actual purchase price in the end, and legal fees of around $10 million, if that's, and of course there's always as high as the sky can go on both of those, it can go up. But basically the math just doesn't work to keep what the mayor promised as rates at the same level and pay off the debt, even with just meeting the debt, the interest on the debt, not putting money into infrastructure as the city said they were going to do, plug the leaks and do a better job and all that. Without any of that, we're still paying higher rates simply because of the cost of purchase.
Now, could it be that because we've gone to the attorneys X amount of times, we might get a frequent flyer discount type thing where they might just cut? No.
I think they get a stamp.
we get green stamps we can put in our...
Here's my question I pose to you two and our listening audience. If this discussion had been forthcoming initially to say, look, let me just lay this out to you, Missoula. Here's the different scenarios of what could happen. First, we have the premise that is it to our benefit to own our own water? Okay, I agree. Great. Sounds like a good idea. Now, let's talk about the different legal scenarios and start looking at the potential costs. Now, I know this wouldn't have happened, but this is how my mind works. Would we be here having this discussion? And would that have been a fair way for the city to present this acquisition?
The problem is the discussion never went public.
To my point, that if I want something that I'm asking you, the ratepayer, to take on, the taxpayers of Missoula, I just want to put this out there for discussion.
Hold on. It went public, sort of, in that it went to the city council, which is representative of the public, okay?
Yeah, of certain segments of the public, since the council is overwhelmingly of a certain political bent. Am I correct?
Yeah, they're overwhelmingly nonpartisan, right?
Right. Yes. Thank you, Peter. Very good.
All together now. Yeah. But anyway, so the argument could be made, but, naysayers, it was open to the public through their elected representatives on the city council. People could have made their views known and asked their councilor to vote in a certain way. And even with that, it was one lone... Oh, opposition vote. It was Adam Hertz, and now it's Harlan Wells. So what are you going to do?
Pass the baton that you beat yourself with.
That's right.
Okay, self-flagellation on the
we're going to say, but let's just put it this way. It is what it is, and we're moving forward. And so just everybody starts saving up.
And I feel good because it's my water.
There you go. All right. So we're going to come right back. So stay with it. Welcome back, everyone, to Talk Back, hour number two, sponsored by Selway Armory on Stockyard Road. More guns and ammo than anyone in Missoula. The best prices in Montana. Montana's premier firearms dealer. Also brought to you by Nissan and Hyundai of Missoula. Now under new management, offering rebates, discounts, 0% financing on a great selection of inventory. And by Bull's Eyewear. They offer some of the lowest prices in town on contact lenses. See Lynette at 2910 South Reserve. Hey, welcome back, everybody. Hour number two, John King. I'm Peter Christian. Bob Seidenschwartz joining us here in studio, and an honored guest on the phone, Bob.
Yeah, we truly are honored to have one of the world's leading experts on the Middle East, Kenneth Pollack. And Kenneth is in Washington, D.C. Kenneth, welcome to Missoula, Montana.
Thanks very much, Bob. Thanks for having me, and please do call me Ken.
Okay, and where else can you get an introduction where guns and ammo are the lead? Because I'm almost positive that's not an ad you're going to hear in Washington. Am I right, Ken?
You're right, but in my part of the world, that's a commonplace.
Right, and just like we were talking about, outside of Washington, D.C. is a whole other world called Virginia, and they do enjoy their guns and ammo, I'm sure, too. So,
yeah, well, please. Shall I go ahead and embarrass?
If you would. We have a short hour with Ken.
I'm going to embarrass Ken the heck out of him because, okay, here we go. Ken Pollack, an expert on Middle Eastern political military affairs, particular emphasis on Iraq, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and other nations of the Persian Gulf. Currently a senior fellow in the Center for Middle East Policy at the Brookings Institution, served as director of the center from 2009 to 2012, and its director of research from 2002 to 2009. His most recent book, Unthinkable Iran, The Bomb, An American Strategy, was named one of the best books of 2013 by The Economist, one of the 100 notable books of 2013 by The New York Times. So, Kent, there you go.
And I'll say one thing real quick, because I've actually read two of Ken's books, one of them being The Persian Puzzle. He's been writing about Iran for quite a long time. Mm-hmm. Things have only become more interesting in the last year, so I'm sure we'll have lots to discuss.
So, Ken, I want to start our discussion by reading a brief excerpt from an article you wrote on March, April 2016. I believe it was Foreign Affairs, Fight or Flight, America's Choice in the Middle East. Even as Middle East careens out of control, help is not on the way. As a consequence, the next U.S. president is going to face a choice in the Middle East. Do much more to stabilize it or disengage from it much more. But given how tempestuous the region has become, both options, stepping up and stepping back, will cost the United States far more than is typically imagined. Stabilizing the region would almost certainly require more resources, energy, attention, and political capital than most advocates of a forward-leaning U.S. posture recognize. Similarly, giving up more control and abandoning more commitments in the region would require accepting much greater risk than most in this camp acknowledge. The costs of stepping up are more manageable than the risks of stepping back, but neither option would be better than muddling through. So with that introduction, please, sir, give and expand upon that in terms of what the next president is going to face, and having described that, please tell us what those challenges are and why stepping back is going to be more costly than, of course, stepping up.
Well, but we've only got an hour to do that, right?
I know. I want you to solve all the problems, please.
Talk really fast.
Okay. All right. So let me give you a thumbnail sketch. First, I think it's important for folks to understand what's going on in the Middle East. And obviously, there's a big, big conversation. I can only lay out the most basic details. But it starts with the fact that basically after the Second World War, after 1945, all of the Arab states in Iran got independence from their colonial masters, and they built these really clunky, dysfunctional political, economic, social systems, you know, autocracies, dictators ruling over oil economies where the people didn't contribute to wealth. The wealth came out of a hole in the ground. And ruling over very traditional social systems. And for 30 or 40 years, it wasn't a very good system, but it kind of clunked along, and it was okay. What we've seen in the last 20 or 30 years is that system is really breaking down, and breaking down badly. It is not delivering for the folks in the Middle East. They are becoming incredibly unhappy. That's why we saw the Green Revolution in Iran in 2009. It's why we saw the Arab Spring revolts in 2011 in the Arab world, because people are extremely unhappy with this combination of dictatorships, oil economies, which are unbelievably corrupt, and a traditional social system that they feel is really kind of under attack from globalization. Right, so we've had unrest and revolts all across the region. And the problem is that while everybody in the region is very unhappy with what they've got, they don't know what they want instead. They associate capitalism and democracy with the West, and they don't like the West. But the truth is that they really aren't interested in Islamism either. You know, we talk a lot about Islamism, the idea of political Islam. The truth is that in the Arab world, when you go over there, when you're in the Middle East, it turns out that only about 20, maybe 25% of the populations there really think that political Islam is a realistic answer. So they don't have an alternative, and the result has been that they have these revolts, and they pull down the government, and they've got nothing to take its place. That produces chaos, right? State failure and civil war. It's what we've seen happen in Syria, in Yemen, in Libya, to a lesser extent, Iraq. It's what we almost had happen in places like Bahrain and Jordan. It's very, very unstable. It's very dangerous. And in particular, these civil wars, and we got four of them now burning in the Middle East, in Libya, in Yemen, in Syria, and Iraq, these civil wars are incredibly dangerous. The problem is they don't stay contained. They spill over. And we see that spill over in the headlines of the newspapers every day. It's the civil wars that are generating the terrorism. It's the civil wars that are generating the refugees. It's the civil wars that are generating the radicalization. And it's threatening to turn these different small civil wars into a great big giant regional war. So these are huge problems that aren't staying contained. And, of course, they're affecting Europe, they're affecting the Middle East, and they're affecting us too. Right?
Hang on, Ken. Go ahead. Go ahead, John.
Yeah, I had a quick question for you, Ken. There's a lot of people, Bernie Sanders is one of them, that say that, you know, this analysis is missing one basic cue, and that is that the key that started all these civil wars going was the push from the United States when we went into Iraq, that kind of triggered this what we're seeing in the Middle East now. When we get back from the break, I'd like you to respond to that. Do you think that we were the tipping point for the region, or was there something else?
We'll be right back. By the way, we have two lines open. If you'd like to visit with Ken Pollack, 721-1290 is our number. We'll be right back. Hey, we're back. This is Talk Back. 721-1290 is our number. Of course, we go all over the world. The Montana World Affairs Council on the radio. Bob Seidenschwartz joining us here in studio. John King is there. I'm Peter Christian, and joining us is Ken Pollack from the Brookings Institution. And now, John, you just asked a question a moment ago. That's something that Bernie Sanders has been saying over and over again in his campaign.
And many in America believe that the problems that are going on in the Middle East are the fault of the United States, and the main thrust of that problem came when we invaded Iraq. I wanted to see if Mr. Pollack agreed with that analysis or not.
Sure. I think it's an important question, John. And the bottom line answer is no. Certainly, what the U.S. did in Iraq caused all kinds of problems, basically for Iraq. And it did create some other tensions, you know, for instance, with Saudi Arabia. President's in Saudi Arabia today, and one of the problems he's got is that we made a mess in Iraq, and the Saudis are unhappy about it, rightfully so. So there's no question that what we did in Iraq was very problematic in a lot of ways. That said, you know, the Middle East is a political football in Washington, like pretty much anything that matters is a political football in Washington. And you get this constant criticism from the left that Iraq was responsible for all of the problems in the world. And again, Iraq, we did a lot of bad things. We made a lot of mistakes. It isn't responsible for all the problems. And in particular, it's not responsible for what's going on in the Middle East today. As I was explaining, the big problems are the breakdown of the Arab state system, the outbreak of these different civil wars, and of course, Iraq got pushed back into civil war. And that's where we can bring the U.S. in, because there is an American role in this, which has been our withdrawal from the region, primarily under President Obama. And I don't think that President Obama's Middle East policy has been wholly bad. I think that he has done some things that have been quite good. But on the whole, I think that his disengagement from the Middle East has been extremely problematic. Because, you know, the countries of the region, they're not used to handling these problems themselves. And you know, we can say, hey, they need to grow up and get with it. The problem is they haven't been dealing with these problems for basically 400 years.
Right.
And to suddenly say to them, you guys got to deal with this, it doesn't make any sense. And our withdrawal has really made the situation worse, because it's panicked a lot of our friends and caused them to do a bunch of things they otherwise wouldn't, which have made the situation worse.
Okay, Bob, go ahead.
So, Ken, you're sitting in the White House talking to the new president, whoever he, she may be, and you say, okay, you cannot disengage from this region for the reasons that you're giving us here today. You need to stay engaged. What type of policy advice, but more to the point, as I've identified, what type of resources do you marshal both from civil society as well as military, and what type of commitment is going to be required? Are we talking several years or several decades in effect of a Marshall-type plan?
Great question, Bob. Okay, so in a nutshell, because we got to be a little bit quick here, and I'm obviously skimping over a lot of the details, but basically I would say to the new president, look, this has to start with an effort to deal with the civil wars. They are engines of instability. Unlike common wisdom, everybody thinks you can't end somebody else's civil war. You actually can. We actually do know how to do it. But it isn't cheap. It isn't easy. It is going to require some additional military muscle from the United States. It is going to require building a wider coalition of European, Asian, and in particular, Arab states. And that's kind of the second point, is there's a lot that we can and need to do to get the ball rolling, to help the Arabs do things that they can't do themselves. But at the end of the day, we've got to recognize that the Arabs are going to need to fix the problems themselves. We've got to encourage them, we got to enable them, we got to give them the incentives to do so, but they're going to have to do it. A big piece of that is not just shutting down the civil wars. That's got to be the first step. The second step has got to be dealing with that other underlying problem I talked about, which is the failure of their political, economic, and social systems. That is a very big task.
Now, Ken, forgive me for
20-30-year project.
Ken, forgive me for jumping in here just a second. I'm looking for a bit of expansive in your comments, just a little bit here. How do you help to solve a civil war without taking sides about an issue that we as Americans probably don't understand very well?
Sure. There's a lot of good history on this, and we've got a lot of experience in doing this. And more or less, you have to do three things. First, you have to create a military stalemate, whereby all the different parties realize that they cannot win a military victory, but they're also safe in laying down their weapons. Second, you have to forge a power-sharing agreement among all of them so that all of the different groups get political authority and economic benefits commensurate with their demographic weight, with their population. And then finally, you have to create institutions that can ensure that the first two conditions continue into the long term.
Let me ask you about that last part, because I think that's going to be the most difficult part. Many of these countries that are going to require institutions that the West has spent thousands of years developing don't have some of the basic institutions: rule of law, trust in the police force, trust in legal system, trust in judicial system or the legislature. I mean, there's just certain elements that aren't going to be there, and that the people are going to have a hard time trusting as if they're just dropped in from out of the sky.
And Ken, give us an example, if there is, of what you described. Sure. And what John is asking about that is work to answer the question that he's raising, because I think there are several.
Sure. I mean, look, you know, you can look at places like Mozambique, right? I'm picking sub-Saharan Africa specifically, and there are other ones out there, right? You know, same kind of a situation. No experience of democracy, no long-term institutions, no sense of rule of law, and yet it was created in a period of about 15 to 20 years, right? You know, we often think about Europe as being, well, they've got all this kind of stuff. You know, it's worth remembering that before 1945, Europe was the worst continent on Earth by far. And you can pull up now on Google all kinds of quotations from American senators and congressmen and other political leaders in 1944 and 45 during World War II, in which they were arguing, look, you know, it is ridiculous to think that we can rebuild Europe, to think that we can bring democracy to Europe. These people are inured to it. They are naturally comfortable with dictatorship. We're foolish to think that we can do it. And of course, we did it. And the same thing is true in East Asia, where people believe that these Confucian cultures couldn't possibly be democracies, couldn't possibly be capitalist systems. Same thing in Latin America, right? We keep saying this about different parts of the world, and then we keep demonstrating it's false. It's really about creating the right circumstances in which people can do the right things.
Well, we're already learning a lot, and we're up against another break. Ken, hang on. We'll do about every 10 minutes or so, just to let you know. We're going to come right back. We have lines open. I don't know about you. I'm learning a bunch just by sitting here listening, and I know you are as well. 721-1290 is our number. The Montana World Affairs Council continues on TalkBack in a moment. Hey, we're back on TalkBack, 721-1290, drums by Bob Seidenschwartz over there. John King and Bob Seidenschwartz, I'm Peter Christian. Go ahead, John.
Yeah, I think Ken did a really good job of responding to my first skepticism, but I have another one that I think may be harder to deal with.
Good.
I'm very skeptical about the United States' ability anymore to have sustained foreign policy, especially after what happened in the transition from the Bush to the Obama years. A lot of the things that you talk about when you're talking about building up an infrastructure, a collective government that represents all the different groups. I mean, we kind of saw the fruits of that in Iraq, and then we saw the current administration throw much of that away. And if in 2 years it gets better and swings the other way, and then in another 8 years it swings the other way, I mean, it's just not a sustainable process, it seems to me, when it's so much of it relies on a linear foreign policy from one country.
And who's in office?
And to John's question, Ken, did the current administration, as it is perceived, throw the gains that were made in Iraq away, or is there another part of the story that you can share with us?
Sure. Let me start with Bob's question, and then I'll come back to John's, because I think they're both great questions. First, as I said, I can give the Obama administration credit in some parts of the Middle East. I think Iraq is one area that they handled extremely badly. And, you know, I don't want to blame everything on President Obama. We have to remember all of the critical mistakes were made under President Bush. That's where the original sin lies. But ultimately, President Bush did make some very courageous decisions. You know, I worked in the U.S. government for 12 years. I know how hard it is for a president to do what he did. I give him a lot of credit for saying, you know what, I've been completely wrong. We need to do the surge. I need to put David Petraeus and Ryan Crocker in there and let them actually do the right thing. They were doing the right thing. Iraq was going in a much better direction. And unfortunately, President Obama came in with this campaign rhetoric of, I just want to get the heck out, and really kind of shot the Iraqis in the foot. And yeah, a big part of what's going on now is kind of recouping some losses that we didn't necessarily need to suffer had we not walked away. So yes, Iraq was another big set of mistakes. We've made a huge series of mistakes under President Bush. Those were compounded by a huge series of mistakes under President Obama, which does kind of bring us back to John's really important question. And you know, look, John, all I can say is I have the same concern that you do. I live in Washington. I have worked in the federal government. I have enormous frustrations with it and our political system, I think like every American, and I share your concern. But, you know, at some level, that doesn't necessarily mean that we just kind of throw up our hands and say, well, we can't deal with this. And I mean, my starting point is the Middle East is in terrible shape. It is getting worse, and it is creating enormous problems for the United States.
Well, let me ask you just to narrow that down. When you say we, who are you talking about? Because I think a lot of my problem was that the United States doing it in the way that it has been doing it probably won't be able to work. I mean, we has to change in some way.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think that we've been doing it in a wrong-headed, kind of a bad fashion. I think there's a better way to do it. But I do think at the end of the day, it is going to be an effort that we are going to have to lead. We don't have to bear as much of the burden as we did in Iraq. That was part of our mistake. I think that there are ways to kind of bring in a lot more help from Europe, East Asia, and in particular from the region, a point I'd love to come back to. But nevertheless, we are going to have to lead it. But, you know, at the end of the day, I said, the Middle East is getting worse. It's not going to go away. I always say to people, the Middle East is not Las Vegas. What happens there doesn't stay there, right? It has a really bad habit of affecting us back here. And, you know, when I look at the Middle East, the problems have become so big. This is the theme of that article that Bob quoted at the outset of the show. The problems have become so big there that just slapping a Band-Aid on it, the way that we traditionally have tried to, just kind of doing just a little bit, try to make the situation a little bit better, and then pretend that it'll all go away, that is not going to work. And we're either going to have to step up in a bigger way. And now stepping up doesn't mean doing what we did in Iraq, but it is going to mean doing more than we're doing right now. Or else we're going to have to step back in a much more dramatic fashion and accept some very big risks in the Middle East that I don't see many Americans willing to accept either.
Go ahead.
So Ken, my apologies for interrupting. You mentioned Asia a couple of times, and we all know when we're talking about Asia, we're talking about China. The majority of the oil that comes out of the Middle East, my understanding is, goes to Pacific countries. So if we're going to have them get the benefit of keeping the shipping lanes open in this region flowing, I cannot imagine that they can continue to be monetarily on the outside. To your point, they are going to have to step up in a more succinct fashion in terms of participation to deal with some of these issues. Is that a premise that's correct?
Absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. And, John mentioned a couple of my books earlier. I wrote a book in 2008. It's called A Path Out of the Desert, A Grand Strategy for America in the Middle East. I warned people of this coming wave of revolution, civil wars, terrorism, etc. I said, we're going to have to promote reform as a way of getting around it. And the last chapter of that book was called Enter the Dragon. And the whole theme of it was to say, look, while the United States is still very reliant on the Middle East, and it's not that we get our oil from it, you're right, it's that the Middle East is still critically important to the global oil market, and our economy is absolutely dependent on a global oil market, even if we're not literally getting our oil from the Middle East. But the simple fact is, China is becoming far more powerful than it once was, and it is becoming far more dependent on that global oil market, and the Chinese are being sucked into the Middle East even though they don't want to be. And, what I talk about in that chapter is about how to bring the Chinese more into it. And there's actually a great historical analogy because, some of you, Peter at the very least, probably remembers that in the period after World War II, for most of the Cold War, it was the British who were responsible for the Middle East. And the British in the 1970s basically said, look, we're tapped out. We no longer have the power that we once did. We're going to have to turn this part of the world over to the new rising superpower, to the Americans. And, of course, we didn't want it. The United States absolutely, we're anti-imperialist. We didn't want anything to do with it. Didn't know from the Middle East. Only wanted to go there, buy their oil, trade with them. That was it. That's where China is today. And we have to do a better job with China, bringing them into it, than we and the British did in that handover back in the 70s.
We're going to come right back. Gregan is waiting to visit with you, Ken. He's on the phone. We also have a line open at 721-1290. Fascinating information. We'd love to hear what your take is on what's going on in the Middle East from somebody who kind of lives and breathes what goes on in the Middle East there at the Brookings Institution. We'll be back in a moment. This is Talkback, and the Montana World Affairs Council on the radio continues.
This is a terrific question, Greg, and honestly, this is one of the big issues that folks like me who work on the Middle East all the time are trying to wrestle with right now. Just quickly, a little bit more background for the listeners. So the king of Saudi Arabia, King Salman, he has a son. He has many sons, but he has one son in particular. His name is Mohammed bin Salman, Mohammed, son of Salman, who is third in line. And then there's a guy in the middle, the crown prince, Mohammed bin Nayef. Mohammed bin Salman, the king's son, the number three in line, is a very young guy. We think he's only about 30. And he is simultaneously very progressive, as Gregan mentioned. He is pushing for reform in a whole variety of different areas all across the kingdom. He's talking about turning Saudi Arabia into a much more modern society, one much less dependent on its oil revenues, all of which would be terrific. But we also need to recognize he also is very conservative in certain ways. He is the guy who has led the Saudi war in Yemen. He is the guy who is pushing hard for the Saudis to take on Iran all around the region. He's the guy who seems to have been the one who said, we're not going to stabilize oil prices with the Russians and the other OPEC countries. And even with his reform agenda, I look at it and say, boy, he's talking about doing things that I have been calling on the Saudis to do for honestly 20 years. And it's fantastic to finally have a senior Saudi prince say, guys, we got to do this. It's fantastic. The downside is he's talking about doing it very fast and in circumstances, as Gregan points out, where the Saudis have all kinds of different problems. The low price of oil is killing them. They've got these military commitments in Yemen and Syria and increasingly in places like Libya and Iraq. That's problematic. They have a succession issue. They've got internal problems within the kingdom. And, you know, one of the things that history teaches is that speed kills, right? And so I look at this and I say, boy, you know, Mohammed bin Salman's reform agenda, it looks fantastic, but I wish he'd slow down a little bit. The speed at which he's trying to do this makes me nervous, right? We've seen other countries try to adopt austerity quickly, like Greece. It often can backfire. What I'm saying is I think that there are good things and bad things about Deputy Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. The U.S. should be trying to encourage him, but also help him to do it in a smart way.
So that brings me to the perfect segue here. You mentioned oil. We've had this conversation numerous times on this show. The fracking revolution has changed the game on a global basis. The oil issue right now is budgets for 2014-15. I'll just name a few countries. Iraq, 81. Libya, 269. Nigeria, 122. Saudis, 105. Venezuela, 117. Those are what oil prices need to be at for the fiscal break-even of these countries. So you're mentioning all these issues moving at light speed. If oil prices stay low, Ken, for the next several years, and that's a distinct possibility, how can the U.S. need to and should look at this as a economic and political weapon that we are able to leverage to help and in some cases or decentivize some of these countries in terms of their behavior?
Yeah, Bob, I'm so glad you asked this question because I think that your question answers itself. It is exactly the right point to make, which is the low price of oil is now killing these countries, and they now realize increasingly that they can't afford not to reform. I mentioned the book that I wrote in 2008, A Path Out of the Desert. I called on the U.S. to kind of push for a reform agenda. And what I heard at that time, and remember, 2008, oil prices had just tripled. That's what caused or was part of the cause of our recession, was this tripling of oil prices. So the Middle East was awash in oil money, and here I am saying these guys have to reform. And everyone was saying to me, how do you get them to reform when oil prices are so high? And it was a very, very difficult argument to make. But now, with oil prices so low, all of them are coming around and realizing they have to do it. So in Iraq, Prime Minister Abadi is trying to put forward a reform agenda. He's having all kinds of problems, but he's trying. In Saudi Arabia, we just talked about how the Deputy Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, who increasingly is emerging as the leader of Saudi Arabia, he is pushing this, you know, quite radical reform program. In the United Arab Emirates, I mean, the last country on earth I would have imagined needed to do this because it's got such a tiny little population and such enormous wealth, both from oil and from investments. They're talking about reform. Morocco, Jordan, all across the Middle East, you have people recognizing that, you know what? The gravy train is ending. Fracking and the shale oil revolution mean that it's unlikely that we're going to see $100-$150 barrel price of oil anytime soon again, and we really are going to need to start to deal with the structural problems in our economies and our societies to be able to survive.
Okay,
this creates the perfect opportunity for the U.S. to step in and say, let us help you.
Okay, we'll be back. We'll continue. This is a fascinating conversation. Michael is also waiting on the line to visit with you, Ken. So we have also have a line open, 721-1290. This is great information. I hope you're taking notes. There won't be a test, but, you know, I want you to take notes anyway. We'll be right back. Okay, we'll ask him that question. Thank you for calling. Okay, Ken, there's your assignment. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, look, there's no question that the various arms manufacturers in the United States, in Britain, France, Germany, Russia, China, they make a huge amount of money on the Middle East. Absolutely no question about it. They make enormous amounts of money on the Middle East. And it's, you know, obviously a question that, folks like me have been asking for a long time, which is, you know, to what extent are either the arms manufacturers or the weapons themselves driving the wars of the region, right? And, you know, I think that there is, it's not a completely off-base idea. There is something to it. You can look at somebody like a Saddam Hussein. Saddam Hussein had a really rotten military, right? They were really, they were just bad. But Saddam didn't realize that, because he was able to buy all kinds of world-class weaponry, mostly from the Russians, but to a lesser extent from the French and some South American countries. And it made him think that he was a lot more powerful than he was. And that clearly was part, it was an input into his decision to invade Iran in 1980, and it certainly also played a role in his decision to invade Kuwait in 1990, and probably thinking that he might be able to beat the United States when we came and kicked him out of Kuwait, was this belief that the weapons that he had bought made him more powerful than he actually was. So it's not like this is completely off base. I think that there is a role to it. But the truth of the matter is that what we see again and again in the Middle East is that most of these countries want the weapons because they want the weapons. And if, we don't sell it to them, they go to somebody else. They literally, we saw this with the Egyptians back in the 50s. The U.S. had an embargo. We refused to sell them weaponry, so they went to the Russians and bought the weapons from the Russians. If they want the weapons and they've got the money, they're going to go ahead and buy it. And in fact, we can also think about it as it's not always bad for us. All through the 1970s, 80s, 90s, even till today, the Saudis buy billions of dollars of American weapons, which prior to their intervention in Yemen, they had never really planned to use. The only reason they did it was as kind of something of a thank you to the United States for protecting them, right? It was a way of creating jobs for the U.S. economy as a thank you to the United States of America, to the American people, for protecting Saudi Arabia. So in some ways, there has actually been some benefit to the weapons. And at the end of the day, I actually kind of feel like this is one of these where guns don't kill people, people kill people, right? The reason we've got wars in the Middle East is because we've got people who hate each other, who want to do horrible things to each other, who want to control each other's land, stuff like that. The weapons, they're episodic. I think if these guys had nothing but sticks and stones and spears, they'd still be killing each other.
Thank you. No, thank you. All right. I think we have a break we got to go to.
We do, yeah.
We'll be right back.
One minute timeout. Stay with us. We have a couple lines open, by the way. Ken Pollack will be with us only for about 7 or 8 more minutes. So if you have a question or comment, now's the time. We'll be right back. Okay, we're back. Just our last segment now, talking with Ken Pollack from the Brookings Institution. I know, just a few minutes left. Go ahead.
I have a dirty question to ask, just to put him out there. All right, of all the presidential candidates out there that are running this session, just pretend that the other voters in the world don't matter. Which one still currently running do you think has the best chance of putting American foreign policy on a path you think would lead to a better world?
Well, who has foreign policy amongst the candidates? That's the question I'd like to rephrase, John.
Well,
it's obviously a hard question to answer, and I really don't want to sound partisan. That ain't my job. I think that either Hillary Clinton or John Kasich could both do quite a good job in terms of foreign policy. Mrs. Clinton, obviously, you can like her, you can hate her, but she has a certain amount of experience with foreign policy. She's been Secretary of State, and what we've heard from her on foreign policy and on the Middle East in particular, again, you can agree or disagree, but it's certainly been responsible, right?
Well,
of the problem is...
Let me ask you about that real quick, because one of the things that you talk about in the fight or flight is you need to make a decision and go with it. You can't waffle. And I hear a lot of waffling from Hillary, a lot of changing her opinion or switching her stance, Yemen today, not tomorrow.
Absolutely. Look, she is a political candidate. And as a political candidate, there seems to be my experience. I'm not a political guy. I'm a policy guy. I'm a strategy guy. But,
I don't know. It looks like we lost our guest. Anyway, I'm sure Ken will give us a call back as soon as he
can. I apologize. That was totally my fault.
Oh, there we go. Hopefully
that's him. Anyway, my humble apologies on that one.
So one of the questions, if we got Ken back, I want to ask is, along the lines of having a foreign policy, do these candidates also have a energy policy that incorporates what we're able to do now because of the difference in our production and where we would seem to be able to keep this moving in that direction?
Okay, fumble fingers here, pushed the wrong button. Ken, I apologize. Thank you for calling back so quickly. Thanks for the call. Okay, so the issue of immigration.
Yeah, another great question, Ruth. So first point I'll make is, again, while there is a great deal of hatred in the Middle East and there's a lot of problems there, again, go back to the point I made earlier. The same thing was true about Europe for 500 years before 1945. As it was the worst planet on the earth, the history of Europe makes the history of the Middle East look calm, sedate, pacific by comparison, right? And nobody has a problem these days with bringing in immigrants from Europe, despite their deeply troubled past. Same thing from East Asia, right? I mean, we forget about the horrors of the Chinese Civil War and the Taiping Rebellion, all those kinds of things. Again, horrific. Second point. Most of the people from the Middle East who are coming to the United States are coming here because they don't want to remain in the Middle East. In many cases, they are frustrated. They've had it with the underperforming economic systems, with the dictatorial political systems, with the backward cultural systems. They're coming to the United States because they want something different. They want what the United States has to offer. They want a country that is much more dynamic, much more forward-looking, much more forward-leaning. And so most of them are coming here with the hope that they can become Americans in all senses of the word.
We only have a couple of minutes. Is this not a critical component of your a precept of being engaged in the Middle East, that if we're welcoming people and doing it the right way, that this also sends a powerful message in addition to the economic and military commitment that we're going to have in this region?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's worth noting that folks out in the Middle East, they recognize that the United States has treated immigrants from the Middle East very differently from how Europe has, right? Europe tends to reject them. There tends to be much greater racism. They keep them in ghettos. They don't assimilate them. As a result, the people are much more unhappy. It's one of the reasons why we have much worse problems of domestic terrorism from the Muslim populations in Europe than in the United States, because we embrace them, because we allow them to assimilate, because they want to become part of our society, and we allow them to do so, and the folks in the region get that. It's one of the reasons why the United States is seen in such a different light in the Middle East from Europe.
Well, Peter, you've been called out on Facebook. Susie says, oh my goodness, someone says something positive about Hillary, and Peter gets nimble fingers. That disconnect? Is it all part of your master plan there?
No, it's just I have big fat fingers, that's all. I know Sue. She's a dear friend.
I was like, oh no, he didn't get to talk about Kasich. I was all excited.
So Ken, in the few minutes that we have left here, on behalf of the Montana World Affairs Council and Missoula, you've never been to Montana, and I want to extend.
I've never been to Montana.
I am going to extend an invitation to you in 2017 to come out as one of our distinguished speakers. So there's the invitation, I will be.
Bring them out during fishing season.
Well, sure. We can sure talk about when we can get you out here, but Ken. There's the invitation to you.
We'll fly you right into Rothschild International Airport.
Yeah. That's right.
Now, I would be delighted to visit your beautiful state, and I hope that my wife is not listening because she is dying to get out there.
Well, okay. There you go. Okay, so Ken, we have exactly a minute. So tell us how we can find out more about your work and the Brookings Institution. What do we do?
Sure. The easiest thing is just to go to the Brookings website on the web. I believe that it's www.brookings.edu. Brookings was founded as an educational organization many, many years ago, and we've hung on to that affiliation or that idea, at least keeping the .edu website address. And you can go to my expert page. If you just go on experts, you can scroll down. There's an alphabetic, and just go to Ken Pollock, and you can find pretty much everything that I've written there, except for my books, which you have to go to Amazon for. And I've got 9 different books on the Middle East, including a couple of bestsellers, and they're all on Amazon or are on barnesandnoble.com or whatever your favorite online purveyor of books or hopefully your local bookstore.
Well, Ken, you have given us some more education in an hour than most could in a semester, and we deeply appreciate your time.
Thank you so much for having me. This has really been such an enjoyable hour for me.
All right. The top of your career now, as we've been on TalkBack now. Thanks so much, Ken.
Thank you, guys. Take care. Have a good day.
Okay, bye-bye. Bye now. All right. So tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow we'll be speaking with Superintendent Mark Thain.
All right. MCPS superintendent. Lots going on there. Of course, they've already started the construction of some of the new schools. So we'll get an update on that. And thank you so much for being with us here on Talk Back. We'll see you tomorrow right here at 6 o'clock for Montana Morning.
John, thank you for making everything work.